to worship. My name is Ed Schenick. I'm the lead pastor here at Monroeville United Methodist Church, and we're gathering out at Monroeville Park West, and we're so glad that you've come out today to join us and that you're joining us here online. As we gather today, we're going to be talking about barriers and the power of God's love that helps us to take them down so that we can build community and build the fullness of life. And so we're glad that you're here for that journey. If you're here in the park, if you're joining us on Facebook, I just like as we gather, we'll play a couple gathering songs. Folks are still coming in from the parking lot. It's a good time to grab a cup of coffee if you're at home. And pick up your phone and dial up Facebook on our site. And just welcome, say hello to one another. I think it's a great way of building community with one another, both here and across the country. And we have some folks sometimes around the world, so we're grateful for this opportunity. So, Marina, would you lead us in a couple of gathering songs?
I sure can.
Is I have seen, and I think if I looked around this morning, I have seen the person who wrote this song. I think he's here in the crowd somewhere. I thought he was back over there. Welcome, Jim. We're glad to have you here this morning.
I've been given up.
for five verses in that.
That's right.
I do have a gripe.
Well, welcome, everybody. And as we begin to move into our worship time here, there's a couple things I just want to lift up for you. First of all, next week is going to be our Mums Cares. And what we do each month at the beginning of the month is we collect items for the food pantry at the Garden City United Methodist Church. And you'll see in our bulletins or in our news blast this week that there are items for school that we're going to be collecting this coming week. So if you can bring in some notebooks, pens, papers, those kinds of things, take a look down, bring them here. We'll have a box to collect them here at the park. We'll have a place, a shopping cart, to collect them at the church. If you're joining us online, you can look up the Garden City United Methodist Church link. There should be a link there in our newsflash that you can donate there. They do a wonderful job, and there are still many people who are in need. So next week, remember Mims Cares. Also, I wanted to remind folks that we are gathering a group together to go to the Holy Land coming up this Lent in March of 2022. We'll be leaving in March the 5th. We'll be celebrating, well, we'll be beginning our journey. Celebration is probably not the right word. Ash Wednesday, we'll be at our Ash Wednesday service. Then we'll gather at the airport, fly to Israel. We're going to go and follow literally the life of Jesus from Bethlehem all the way up through the Sea of Galilee, come back down into Jerusalem. And the last week before we come home, the last day, we'll be walking the Via Dolorosa. All of that information's there. We would love to have you as part of the journey. So take a look and see if you'd like to join us. That's coming up next March. But the information, you need to get working on it right away. I'm working on my passport right now. So hopefully you'll come and join us. Also, if there are those of you who are interested in becoming part of our community, Donna Tattarella had left me a note that we're going to be putting together a meeting to get together on Thursday, August the 19th. If you have questions about Mom, if you'd like to learn more about us, if you have children you'd like to have baptized, all of those things, we'll be gathering together at the church. I'm also going to put that on Zoom. So keep an eye open. If you're interested in any of these things, just mention that in our chat, and we'd be happy to get in contact with you. As always, you matter to God, you matter to us, and there's always a place for you here. Let us continue our worship with a song of praise. And Marina, would you, you've taught us this one, would you lead us this morning?
I sure can. And this is actually a song, ironically I work in HR now, and my coworker suggested this one to me, so shout it to Nancy. All right. I've had good days, I've had bad days, tasted victory in defeat. I've had problems big as planets turn to pebbles when you speak. I've had nothing to my name, never lacked for anything, 'cause you were there. Thank you.
my mother and my father, brother, sister, and friend. Everything I've needed, you always been. Everything I needed, you've always been. Everything I needed, you've always been.
Loving God, we come together now and open ourselves to you who provides all that we need. You nurture us, you guide us, you strengthen us. Open our hearts now as we seek to reach out to you, that we would be filled with your Spirit and empowered through this week, that others would see your good news in all we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And I think it's time now for our kids, and we have Amanda and Captain. Oh, no, Captain's staying there. Okay, just Amanda. I wondered if you were going to introduce Captain to us. Okay.
All right, good morning. All right, in my hand, I have, actually, Pastor Ed talked about this. What is this? Some of you in the back probably can't see it, but passport, right. Mine's expired, so I guess I'm not going anywhere for a little while. A passport, when I show this passport in the airport or if I'm traveling around, it shows that I'm a citizen of the United States of America, whatever's on your passport. So my friend Sandra has a passport from Zimbabwe. So hers says Zimbabwe on the front, and it says that she's a citizen of Zimbabwe. Well, I'm a citizen of the United States of America, and it shows that I belong to this country. And as we cross boundaries and lines and all those kinds of things, we have to show our passport to say that we can travel and we're allowed to come in and out of different countries. And they give you a stamp. So I have a couple stamps in here as well. But overall, this is just showing that I belong to the United States. Well, in the scripture that Pastor Ed's going to read later, we're going to talk about how we're all citizens of God. And no matter where we're from or what language we speak, or what the boundary lines are, we all can come together because we all belong to Christ and we're all citizens together in God's kingdom. And that's a very good thing to be. So let's go ahead and pray. Lord God, we are thankful that you call us your own, that we belong to you, and that we are citizens of your kingdom, no matter where, what we look like or where we're from or what language we speak, that you break down those lines so that we can all be together. And what a beautiful picture that is. And so, Lord, we just thank you for loving us, and we pray that you help us to love others this week as well. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I'd like you to take a moment as we do each worship, and hopefully in the midst of the day, to think a little bit about the things God has given you. Take a deep breath, as we talked in a song about breathing, to remember that each very breath you take is a gift. This very life is a gift. This community is a gift. And the people that are around us that God sends to us, those who may challenge us, those who lift us, those who help to guide us, those who encourage us, all of those things come from God. Where did you see God this week? And where do you give thanks? I give thanks to this, to God for this church and for the many people who are working to continue to make sure that the ministries come to you online and that come to you who are here and gathered. I give thanks for all of the special services that we've had over the past weeks. Services of memorial and the many people who came out to support and give thanks for a life well lived and to support that family that's in grief. So many ways that we see the Spirit of God's love moving. For those places in our world where in the midst of divisions we see love and we see compassion that steps across the boundaries and builds bridges of hope and of life. I give thanks for those. And give thanks to you in the way that you continue to support the ministry here at MUM. And as we're here and online, there should be a way that you can tag into to help and support the ministries. Folks here, there's a basket that's out on the table. All those ways are ways online, ways that you can help to continue these important ministries. And I thank God for you. Let us take a moment and let us just take a breath. Where has God blessed you this week? Loving God, some of us are sitting here in the midst of creation and hear the birds sing. And mindful of the world, the universe you have created, and that we get to be a part of it. Lord, who breathes life into us at every moment, continue to breathe through us, that the world would see your presence, your love, your good news in the way we live. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue our gratitude with a song.
Those of you that might know, I appreciate the chance to sing here when we get a chance as a solo, and I don't think we'd be able to get through a summer without hearing some Johnny Cash. Oh, no, I know, you're okay, all right. I see a lot of people out there. You've been waiting all summer, haven't you? I have too. I've been waiting myself. But the one thing I really like about sharing anything that I've grown to have a personal song with that Johnny Cash has done, I like to add that his character as a performer was always one that he never had pretension, he never hid anything that he had troubles, he never made it seem like he was better than anybody else, and therefore whenever he sang a religious or a gospel song, you knew that it meant that to him. It wasn't just the lyrics, and that you could tell whenever he sang those things. And I like to carry that with me too, in that a song has to mean something to you. You can't make it up. And we always, you guys know that with everybody that we sing with every week, you know, that it means something to us, and that's why we're all here. So just keep that in mind here. Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along till the Lord comes and calls me away, oh yeah. Well, the morning's so bright, and the Lamb is the light, and the night is as black as the sea. There will be peace in the valley for me, oh yes. There will be peace in the valley for me, dear Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley for me. Well, the bear will be gentle, and the wolf will be tame, and the lion shall lay down with the lamb, oh yes. And the beast from the wild will be led by a child, and I'll be changed from this creature that I am. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, dear Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley.
come now to a time of prayer. And our prayer song this morning is Breathe, reminding us that every breath is a gift. And as we come together now, I'm going to invite folks that are online, if there are people you would like us to be praying for, to put them in the chat. There'll be people reading those right here and praying for you. And also, we'll be adding those on to our prayer chain for the rest of the week. In addition to that, I have some requests that have been made of coming into here. I'll lift those up. So we'll sing in prayer. This is the air I breathe, your holy presence. This is my daily bread, your very word spoken to me, the very presence of God that is with us. And then we'll break to lift up those things that are on our hearts before God. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily God, we lift up praises for so many gifts. We thank you for Alex and Jaron, who are going to be married this afternoon after a long wait with COVID. That your blessings would be with them in their new life together. We give you thanks for our youth and for the youth across our conference who were at Youth for Missions this week, and the way you empowered them to make a difference in others, and for all of those who went and those who made it possible. Lord, we give you thanks. We're grateful, Lord, for Meech, who we sent to Georgia for an engineering seminar, and for the blessings that came out of that, that he's home and has grown so much. We thank you for all the ways you continually bless. We're mindful of those who are grieving, Lord. There are many who have lost loved ones in the midst of this pandemic. There are many who are facing this time with empty spaces in their tables, in their homes, and in their hearts. We're mindful, O God, that you are a God of comfort and a God who lifts, Emmanuel, very present help. We lift up those who are suffering with wildfires out in the West, and that's expanding this year for those who have lost so much, those who are in danger. We lift up this continuing pandemic, and Lord, there are places where it is beginning to rise again, and there's still places across the world. To empower those who are reaching out with healing, with your spirit, for you are the one who heals. In our community here, we lift up Lynn, who's recuperating from surgery, and Claire, who now is home. For Geneva, Norma, Jeanette, Dan, Vi, Sam, Roger, Don, Arlene, Sue, who is in hospice, a neighbor of Lori's, a friend of Donna's, and all in those who are in our hearts that are beyond our knowing individually, but you know them, Lord. Bring your healing, your blessing, your peace.
This is the end.
as we breathe in now, remind us of your presence. And in those difficult times this week, may we take a breath and be reminded that there is no place, nothing height nor depth nor anything that takes us away from you. And because you are with us, there is always hope. Empower our love as we seek to reach out into your world this week. There are so many in need, that they may see your light. They may taste the salt of love and grace and peace and justice. That they might see your very presence in the way we live our lives. That we may be your church. In Jesus' name. It was taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Children said, Amen. Hang on just a moment and let me get my Bible and I'll put down my guitar. We have been in the season of Pentecost where we celebrate the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we've been talking about that Holy Spirit, the difference God's presence makes in our lives over the last several weeks. We talked about the importance to keep that fire, that flame alive in our lives. And we talked about taking time for Sabbath. And I know I'm getting a lot of good stories of vacations that people are getting away for a little bit, or even just getting out for an afternoon and just taking a breath and getting away, how important that is. We talked about stretching out and reaching out and pushing ourselves beyond our little comfort zones, that God's presence and promise can be made full in us. We talked about sowing seeds so that people would come to know the blessings that God brings to us. Today, I'd like us to think about barriers, the walls that we can build, and the power that God's love has to help us and empower us to take them down so that we experience the fullness of God's community that's beyond us, that brings the fullness of life. Paul is talking about that very power that Christ brings to us in his letter to Ephesus, Ephesians. I'll be reading this morning in the Message, which is a translation by Eugene Peterson. Let us open our hearts that we might hear God's word for us. But don't take any of this for granted. It was only yesterday that you were outsiders to God's ways and had no ideas of any of this. You didn't know the first thing about the way God works, hadn't the faintest idea of Christ. You knew nothing of that rich history of God's covenants and promises in Israel. You had no clue about what God was doing in the world at large. And now because of Christ dying and shedding blood, you who were once out of it altogether are in on everything. The Messiah has made things up between us so that we're now together on this, both non-Jewish outsiders and Jewish insiders. He tore down the wall that we used to keep each other at distance. He repealed the law code that had become so clogged with fine print and footnotes that it hindered more than it helped. Then he started over. Instead of continuing with two groups of people separated by centuries of animosity and suspicion, he created one new kind of human being, a fresh start for everybody. Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace, and that was the end of the hostility. Christ came and preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. He treated us as equals, so he made us equals. Through him, we both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? We're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom faith is now your home country. You're no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here, with as much right to the name Christian as anyone. God is building a home, using all of us, irrespective of how we got here in what he's building. He used the apostles and the prophets for the foundation. Now he's using you, fitting you brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all the parts together. We see it taking shape day by day. A holy temple built by God. Built, all of us built into it. A temple in which God is quite at home. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I remember a friend of mine whose church burned. And the congregation was absolutely shattered. This was the home, this was their church. And it had been built, and it had memories that went back generations and generations. And they sat there and said, what are we going to do now? We've lost our church. God sent them out on a wilderness journey. God took away the building, the barriers, the walls they had used to keep themselves inside. And the pastor said, what are we going to do? We're going to hold worship next week. And they got a tent area, although he went back and forth on that because he said that's still a boundary line, but there's no walls in it. And they began to have worship services in their front yard of that church as they began to build a building. And it became very apparent to them that the church is not a building. Amen. The church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is the people. And people that come from all parts of life. Christ is continuing to build. And that's what Paul is talking about here. Now, he's talking in a very important time. There's a church that's coming together that had been apart for many, many generations. There are those who were Jews, like Paul. And there were those who were Gentiles. Now, oftentimes we've kind of lost touch with what that word meant, but Gentiles were simply non-Jews. They were not circumcised. They were not bar mitzvahed, bat mitzvahs. They were not in the law. They were not keeping the law. What made a Jew, and still does, is to follow the Torah. Now, the Torah gets interpreted, and people look at it a different way, but it's living a Torah life is what makes a Jew a Jew. But the message of Christ had moved out from the Jewish community and into what would be the pagan community, the Greek-speaking community, the world. And suddenly people began to hear about the message of Jesus, about love, about a God who calls and heals. And those who were from those other communities that were not Jews began to believe in Jesus. And they called themselves Christian. And they sought to follow Jesus. And there was a fight that went on in the church at that time. Because those who were Jews, like those who would follow Jesus, said, wait a minute, Jesus is the Messiah of the Jews. In order for you to be saved, you need to be circumcised, you need to become a Jew, and you need to keep the law. And if you don't keep the law, then you're not really part of us. And Paul and many of Paul's contemporaries sought to change that very law. To say no. The grace of God revealed in Jesus on that cross is alone enough. Jesus doesn't need a law book to save your soul. God used Jesus to build a bridge. And there really is one church, and that's what he's arguing in here. See, the members of the Jewish community in his language there were the circumcised. These were Jews who came to understand Jesus' walk as Messiah. And the others Well, they'd never been in the Jewish community. They never knew about Abraham. They never read and followed the laws as written down. But they experienced a God of love, and they experienced a community, and they began to move together. And so you had Gentile churches, and you had Jewish churches. And the real issue at the bottom of this really isn't about circumcision, per se, whether to get little Johnny circumcised. The issue underneath this is really this. Upon what is my relationship with God based? Is it based on my following a law? If I follow the law, then I'm blessed and God loves me. Actually, when I grew up in the church, that was a message I got in a lot of places, didn't you? You know, Jesus gives us his law. If we follow the law, you know, I'm climbing Jacob's ladder. We use that image. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. God is at the top of the ladder, right? And we're climbing our way up. That's what the law is about. And yet it's interesting. If you go to the story of Jacob's ladder, you'll find that God never asked Jacob to climb Jacob's ladder. In fact, Jacob is running from his brother Esau, who's trying to kill him. His life is totally blown apart. He doesn't know where he is. He's laying in the middle of a wilderness, sleeping on a rock. And suddenly he has this vision where there's this ladder, and if you remember, the angels were ascending and descending on it. It wasn't about how Jacob climbed to be with God. It was about how God came to be with Jacob. And Jacob woke up in the morning and said, "Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place, and I didn't know it." What a wonderful statement of grace. God came to him, and later on, Jesus will use that very phrase for himself. You will see the angels of God ascending and descending, very same language, upon the Son of Man. The language he used for himself, going to a cross. Not about how we climb our way up to God, but about the message of good news that God in love has come to us and has taken away the barriers and says, "Come and follow me." Whether you've read the Bible, whether you've not read the Bible, whether you've been in church all your life, whether you've never been in church all your life, whether your life is all together or your life is absolutely in pieces, it doesn't matter because God loves you and I've come here to claim you home. So the church isn't just about the people who climbed the ladder. It's about a God who is coming to claim all humanity. You hear the difference? And so he's talking in that language, and he's reminding them of all the barriers that they had placed. See, back in the time of Jesus, the Jewish community had set up many different barriers. The Pharisees at that time had 650 different laws about how you made food and didn't make food, and how you ate and who you ate with, and how you did this and how you did that. It was all spelled out. Many of the Pharisees' laws aren't in there, but the different covenant codes are still there. And you can see all the ways that they divided themselves. Actually, even in the temple, if you went to the temple in Jerusalem, you'd find the Holy of Holies here, and then there's a curtain, and then you'd find the court of the men, because the men were the men, right, ladies? Anyways, and then you had the court of the women, because the women were not seen as much as the men in that time, and there was a barrier there. And then you had the court of the Gentiles, the people who weren't part of the Jews. And when Jesus is overturning the temple, remember that story? He's in the court of the Gentiles. See, for the people in the church at that time, they're like, "Who are these people? We don't really care. We're going to swap, you know, different things that we need for our religion, and we're going to make all kinds of money here, and we're going to turn it into..." And Jesus said, "No. All of us should be part of that community. We need to take down the barriers." And if you remember, then I'll just use this as a last instance just to sort of tie this together, but if you remember when Jesus died on the cross on Good Friday, one of the first things that said is that the temple curtain was torn in two. Remember that? I remember when I was a kid and I heard that, I thought, "God is really ticked. You know, he's really..." I mean, it's like taking a phone book and just ripping it up, you know? And that's the way I visioned that. But then I heard about the barriers. What God was doing, that curtain separated. It was the barrier between the Holy of Holies, God, and the community. It was gone. A statement of love, not anger. And so that's what Paul is talking to the men, reminding them how Christ broke down those barriers. See, the Christians began to see Jesus as the sacrifice that brought us all together. And so to focus instead on the teachings and example of Jesus and open ourselves to a Holy Spirit that comes, that we might come together. Atonement
at one with God, and at one with one another. That's what atonement means, at one ment. Okay, I put a hyphen in it. So listen to Paul as Peterson translates. He says, the Messiah made up between us so that we're now together on this, non-Jew and Jew insider. He tore down the walls we used to keep each other at distance. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom faith is now your home community and country. You're no longer strangers or outsiders. God is building a home, and he's using you, all of us, irrespective of how we got here, in what he's building. The church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is the people. And the barriers came down. Actually, William Barclay, I love reading him. He's a scholar from a number of years ago in England, but I love reading his stories. And back in World War II, he tells the story of this group of soldiers, and they had lost one of their comrades, and they wanted to have him buried. And so they came up to a church there in France, and they had a cemetery on the side, and they went to the priest, and they said, can we bury our friend here? And the priest looked at them and said, well, is he baptized? See, that's our circumcision. That's our badge, right? And they said, well, we don't know. We never really asked him. And the priest said, well, then I can't bury him in the cemetery because that's for Christians. So what they did is they had this metal fence that went around the outside of the cemetery, and they buried him right up to the side of the fence. And they went out, and they did their job, their duty. About a number of weeks later, they came back, and they noticed something had happened, that the fence that was there on the inside where the cemetery was gone, and actually the fence had been built around their friend's grave. And they went to the priest, and the priest said, you know, the more I thought about it, it just didn't seem right to me. So we went and we moved the fence. See, that's what God did for you and for me and for the world. For God so loves the world that he gave his only son. So as we think about that very powerful time, that really has a lot of power, at least to me, and I think maybe to many of us, how many of us were raised in the Jewish church? How many of us were circumcised and ritually brought up in the Jewish church? See, we're Gentiles. This is our story. And the two things I want you to think about really are this. Number one, do you realize that God loves you? Whether you've climbed the ladder or not, whether you got it all together or not, whether the world is looking wonderful to you or you're in the lowest possible valley, there is a God who is coming to you and loves you. You are precious. And to take away the barriers that we build, thinking we're not good enough, that somehow God isn't going to come to me. I remember a man when I was working in the detox ward as a chaplain, and I walked in the doorway, and he looked at me, and he goes, you know, chaplain, he said, you don't want to do anything to do with the likes of me. Oh, yes, I do. Because it's the very presence of God's Holy Spirit that will empower you to get off of the alcohol that's holding you down so you can be set free. That's true for all of us. And secondly, am I aware of the boundaries that I draw, of those who are in and those who are out? Sometimes, as much as I really don't want to think about it, I'm like that priest. I have that group that's insiders. And it's often, if I think about it, the insiders suddenly begin to think a lot like me, look a lot like me, talk a lot like me, have my culture, right? Is that really God? And there's this little twinkling inside that says, you know what, God may be a lot bigger, and God may be sending someone to me that helps me see a bigger picture of the world and the God who created it. Where are those people I tend to turn away from? Let's just pick one this week. Whether it's about socioeconomic, it's about race, it's about sex, it's about whatever. And let's reach across that boundary line and step across the barrier. Not to enforce anyone on faith or enforce our faith on anyone, but just to listen, to learn, and to see the beauty that God has created. You are loved. And there is a God who will not let us go. Let you go, let me go. And to that I say, amen. What about you? Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, who broke down the barriers, break down the barriers in our hearts. We are so divided. May your Spirit empower us with your love, that all may hear in our lives, in our tongues, in what we do, your good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we close our time together, we have a song that actually was written during the pandemic. It's a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. How many of you have heard that? So we know the words. And it was written during the midst of the pandemic as a way of reminding us in the midst of that dark time of the presence of God. Let us sing it as the blessing as we part our ways today.
Lord bless you and keep you.
God's children said. Amen. Have a great week, everybody. And let's let our light shine. Let us take down the barriers that others may see the love of God in us. Let us go and let us serve the Lord. Take care, everyone, and we hope to see you next week.
Later.